Which is the Developing Speaking Fluency in the First Semester, presented by Masha Sertunch, who is the team leader, and Victoria Karadova, who is the assistant team leader. We have one paper of a handout. If you didn't get it, I can pass it to you. Everybody had it? Has it? And then also we have a sign-in sheet. So if you didn't sign in, you can do that on the way out. Also, at the very end of the session, we have presentation evaluation form that I would like you to fill out and give it to me, and we will really appreciate your sincere evaluation of this session. Thank you, and I give the floor to the ladies.
Okay, we would like to welcome and thank everybody for coming here today. We would like to start our presentation with the topic of our presentation is developing speaking fluency in the first semester. The presenters today is Victoria Karalova and my team leader, Masha Sertunch. Okay, we would like to start our presentation with three fundamental pillars that we created in our team, and we stick to it throughout the whole course. First of all, it's patience. Second of all, it's persistence. And it's a professionalism. Throughout the whole course, we would like to stick to those fundamental pillars that we created. And learning language is not an easy task. We would like to demonstrate a vivid example for you guys by showing you a video.
So you probably all know this show, a lot of us grew up with it, and that's more like what not to do, but we think we as language teachers always had at least one of these students.
All right, this seems pretty simple. Your first line is, my name is Claude, so just repeat after me. Je m'appelle Claude.
Je te coupe plow.
Try again.
Okay.
Je m'appelle Claude.
Je t'appelle Blue.
No, it's not quite what I'm saying.
Really? Sounds exactly the same to me.
It does? Really?
Yeah.
All right, let's just try it again.
Okay.
Really listen.
Got it.
Je m'appelle Claude.
Je te flou.
Oh, mon Dieu.
Oh, the foof.
Okay, so at least once did you have a student like that? Come on, guys. Yes,
yes.
We did.
Yes, thank you. Thank you.
That's why another word we need to remember. Patience, persistence, and professionalism. We would like to start with the goals for the first semester. The first goal that we have, students should not be afraid to talk, to use the language spontaneously. That's why from the day one, our students come into our class, they are not prepared, they don't know what is going to happen during the course. And with the day one, we introduce them with a special activity. Our co-worker that she's not with us anymore. She's not working with us anymore, and it was developed by her. We started with rapping alphabet with our students. They're not only uncomfortable by coming, not knowing their teachers, they're also starting rapping letters of the language that they don't know. We're trying to make them more comfortable in the language that they're going to learn. And that's why our goals and that students won't be able to be afraid to use the language spontaneously. And students start to communicate, start their development gradually. But soon forced to start communicating in phrases and not in separate words. Learning and coming gradually to a sentence level.
So our team from very early on requires target language to be the only language in the classroom or on the floor. Students do not necessarily like it. they always try to find a way out of it. We stay firm and patient, and we persist and persevere, and we just forget English very conveniently. Every single time our students try reverting to English in their communication to us. We do come down to their level, which means at the beginning, we communicate with them just like they do with us, with board, computer, teacher, good, student, good, bad, not good. So we try to be a little bit silly, but meet them at their level, and then as they progress, we grow with them. So a lot of students really embrace it, because when they come, we explain that what is language? Language is the means of communication. How do we mainly communicate? We communicate by speaking. So if we just focus on listening and reading, your brain gets confused, especially if you didn't have exposure to a foreign language before. So in order to help the brain adjust and adapt to a new, odd, different, strange language, it needs to think that it will communicate in it. So in this way, we create the immersive environment to as much as we could possibly sustain it in the day life. Also, we try, in the topics that we discuss with students plus daily life, we try to reuse and recycle vocabulary of the units. So once the unit is done and over, they do not forget about it, but they use it naturally in everyday life. And we are lucky in the way that the Russian program, the first couple of modules, kind of grow with the students in the natural way. Are we going to do this?
Yes.
Okay,
we want to show you another example what not to do.
Yeah, that's a definite no-no. But I think a lot of us share the feelings. Or not. Okay. Come on.
Je m'appelle Claude.
Je me call Blue.
Okay, maybe we just break it down. Okay, let's try it one syllable at a time. Okay, so repeat after me. Je m'appelle. Great, okay, faster. Je m'appelle. Je m'appelle.
Mi poupou.
Okay, been there, done that? Doing it all the time, that's okay. So.
Okay, today we would like to get accustomed with Eric Erickson's theory centered on psychosocial development. What is psychosocial development? Like Sigmund Freud, Eric Erickson believed that personality developed in series of stages. Eric was interested in how social interaction and relationship played a role in a development and growth of human beings. While we recognize that our students, adult learners here at DLI, we would like to compare the process of their language acquisition. They go through the development stages of a growing child, pretty much. They overcoming the same challenges and following similar patterns. We're going to compare student speaking fluency with the growth with the growth stages of a human being. Of physical development by Eric Erickson. He has eight stages, but today we're only gonna go through four of them because in our presentation we only cover the first semester. And the first stage of physical psychosocial development by Eric Erickson is trust versus mistrust. Approximately, if we would take a child, it's going to be from 0 to 18 months of their physical development. usually at that stage, infant is utterly dependent, developing trust. Trust is based on the dependability and quality of child's caregivers. In this case, we can compare with the teachers in a class. Child successfully develops trust if he or she feels a safe, secure, and secure. And failure to develop trust will result in fear and belief that the world is inconsistent and unpredictable. That means when we compare this particular stage, it's pretty much for our students as learning letters. We're going to go to the second stage, is autonomy versus shame and doubt. Approximately, if we would look at the child, it's going to be the period between 2 years to 3 years old. Early childhood is usually focused on children developing a greater sense of personal control that later can develop in autonomous learner experience. And that's what we're pretty much trying to get out of our students at DLI. At this point, they are starting to gain a little independence, and they start to perform basic actions on their own and making simple decisions and deciding about what they prefer and don't. At this stage, if we compare it with our students, it's pretty much creating sentences, primitive structures. That's what our students do.
So we are talking about basic odd sounds that our respectful languages do. For Russian, it's going to be the and you know, we have a lot of fun with trying to say it. So the students learn to make sounds just like the babies do when they grew up. And then they put the sounds into words, and then they try communicating by words. And then our job is to kind of wait for them and guide them to start putting words into sentences. And hopefully, you know, they can build on that. We do not help them. We do not give them answers immediately. When we see a student struggling to produce something, we give them space and time to be able to get it out and get some confidence in their own abilities. Because if we always help them, then they become totally dependent on us, as opposed to and afraid of what they really can do.
Okay, we're going to move to the next stage, the third stage. It's initiative versus guilt. We would consider this stage in a child like approximately 3 to 5 years. Those are preschool years. Children begin to assert their power and control over the world through directing play. And pretty much it's a role play. And other social interactions that they usually do. Successful children usually capable and able to lead others. Those who fail to acquire these skills are left with a sense of guilt and self-doubt and lack of initiative. In this case, like our students starting to act in a, and act out role plays. And
So for example, at the end of the first module, our first speaking exam, Russian program has the trip to a store. So a student comes to a clothing store and the student needs to purchase whatever they want to purchase, let's say a shirt. Okay, student is a buyer, teacher is the salesperson, and then the student tries to explain to us that they want a shirt of this color, this size, produced in this country, made of that material. And then we see how far we can stretch the students. Normally you wouldn't give the complications that early, but we like to experiment, so we see if the student is clearly comfortable. We try to say, oh, we don't have it, or you know, we have off-white instead of white, and see if they can negotiate with us a little bit. Or we tell them a higher price and see if they can talk it out. So those are the basic interactions when they think they are in control and we let them think about that they are, which is great for their self-esteem.
So you don't correct them? Like
on the exam, we don't.
If he's off.
We correct them in speaking classes when we are working on certain skills. We give them, we always give them feedback, either written or oral. So if we're working, for example, of the verb and adjective correlation in class right now, we're going to be correcting that. But what we do, we let them finish. We explain the mistake. We have them say it over with the correct way so they are more aware of that relationship.
After the role play?
For the role play, yes, after the role play. Those role plays, if I don't understand them, I just say I don't understand you.
And then you put them in the situation.
And then they will try to figure it out how to, I mean, think about it. You come to a foreign country, you want to go buy something, they don't speak English, you don't speak their language, what do you do? You try somehow to find your way, or, you know, me trying to negotiate in Spanish with a contractor we have who doesn't speak English. My level of Spanish is 0+. I have basic words, I try to somehow figure it out. And eventually I get better. But there is, we do not have a one thing, one size fits all approach. It depends on the student. Some students really break if you correct them all the time. So at first, we just correct them on basic things like pronunciation if we cannot understand them, or basic proper grammar because this, like Russian is structured, so you need to at least follow a certain way of putting words together. That we would correct. Everything else, like towards the end of the third semester, we don't even need to correct them at all. We just look at them, and they already know that, that they need to correct themselves, and they will correct themselves if they need to.
Special look, like as if you give a sign?
We don't. We don't. They learn to read our body language. They say, you look at me funny. So now I try not to, like, when I'm listening to them, I try to sit like this, so they cannot read my face. Okay, go ahead.
We're going to move to the next stage. Is the last stage that we're going to check out in our presentation today is the fourth one, industry versus inferiority. In a child's life, it's usually we would put it in a time frame 5 to 11 years, and it's all about social interactions. Successfully find a balance at this stage of psychosocial development leads to the strength known as competence, in which children develop a belief in the abilities to handle the task set before them. That's pretty much by the end of the first semester they should be at this stage, comparing with our students. They should be able to participate in not very advanced, like primitive social, in primitive social interactions. And
Yeah, so it's pretty much like our short conversation. Mm-hmm. Hey, what are you doing this weekend? Or what did you do last weekend? Or what kind of coffee do you like? Or what does your mom do? Did you have a job before? That's what we do, right? We do it anyway here. Mm-hmm. So we try to make it unscripted, spontaneous, and just see how far the conversation can go before we all come to a point where either there is nothing to talk about because we ran out of vocabulary, or we need to stop and talk about perhaps some restructuring of the way we put the words together.
And we're going to talk about activities for the first semester that we do. We usually do a lot of activities in our classes. And unfortunately, we have a limitation of time today in our presentation. That's why we're only going to present just a few of them for you to see what we do during the first semester. Our students get into routines, you know, of common listening, reading, and doing any other kind of developing different skills that they need to during the course. And we try to make it fun. You know, we need to remember that learning language can be fun. That's why we would like to present one of the activities that we do for the first semester.
So, during week 6, and it really doesn't matter, beginning and end of week 6, sometime whenever it works, we do a loyalty card program. So it is like the, you know, membership program that accumulate points for you, like Lucky's supermarket, okay? So what we do is first we give them a reading assignment. It takes 2 hours total. First hour, they get a reading assignment. It is absolutely untouched by editing from our side, so it is just pulled off the website of the program, printed for the students, and then they have questions. So we make sure that that particular segment of text will have lots of cognates, lots of borrowed English words that now exist in Russian, so they could actually understand what it is they're reading, but it is not boiled down to their level at all. It's what you will see in real life, okay? So they have to read it and then answer questions like, where can you say now? How do you say now? How do you accumulate points? Where do you spend the points? Can you roll them over? Stuff like that. Students work in groups of two because working with a partner is way more fun than doing it alone. And also the philosophy of our team is we are a team, we have to work together. DLI is a marathon and it's a team sport. As an individual, it's very difficult to make it here. So that's the first hour. After we know they understand the point of the program, we want them to enroll into the program. And this is when it gets fun. So they all get an application, okay? And their job is to fill out the application, but not for themselves, but for a neighbor. So how it works? We have student number one and student number two. And it's like a role play. Student number one wants to open an account with that particular program. Student number two works for that program and will be helping student number one to open the account. They both have a copy of the application. They go to the different areas in the building, perhaps even outside, doesn't matter, but they should not see each other. They're gonna call each other on the phone. And student number one will call and say, hey, my name is, I heard about this wonderful program. I would like to please open an account with you. And student number two will walk him through the application process, getting all the information. And this is the time when they learned that, so we recycle the vocabulary that they just learned. The last name, the occupation, the address, some of the words there they don't know yet, but they can figure it out. For example, the electronic address, well, that's your email, they can figure it out. So they do that, and then the student who works writes down all the information, and then after they're done, they switch. And at the end, they bring us their filled out application. So the cool thing about it is we did not warn them they were going to do it. It was completely unscripted. They got no homework, no prep work, absolutely nothing. They came to class, first hour, we just landed on their desk the description of the program. Second hour, we said, hey, time for a walk, get your phones, go call each other. And then we'll meet you back in 50 minutes to see what you guys accomplished. And the stronger students managed to go through the whole exercise. The weaker students would only go through like maybe 2/3 of application each. But still, it was a really empowering experience for them because they could speak in the target language on the phone without the clues of the body language, and they understood one another, and we did not have to babysit them. So it was a great experience for them.
Well, how do you control them not speaking English?
You don't.
You know, they could just communicate over in English and then just...
You don't. We trust our students to be honorable. Also, we spy.
I also have a question. Uh-huh. It's very interesting. My question is, since the students are in week six, so are they able, do they have a lot of vocabularies to produce
utterances? Yeah, they do.
Plus, the sentences you use, like I have heard about it, like, you know, the tenses, the structures. We can push them, of course, but how it is challenging. Like, if you see students are always in their comfort zone, when you push them a little bit, it's a learning zone. If you push them more, it's a panic zone. So, have you experienced panic zone sometime or no?
With this particular class, we did not get panic zones just because from day one, we forgot English.
Okay.
Unless it was absolutely necessary. So they were really used to expect the unexpected, and the fact that we were not there physically, like
by their side, always listening to them. Oh, so I made a mistake, so he understood me. I know, I walked by one of the students in the hallway on the phone, and he had to repeat the same sentence 3 times, and he was getting really annoyed. And then he looked at me, and I looked at him, and I'm like, okay, and he's okay. They figured it out.
Yes. I also have another question. Yeah. Since the students are coming with different learning styles, so do you give students preference of choosing how they want to be corrected? Like in semester one, some students want to be corrected on the spot, as much as you go in semester two, students do not want to be corrected on the spot, they want to complete their sentence.
As a team lead, I leave it to the speaking teacher and that speaking teacher's group.
Okay.
So I know I run my group in a way that she wouldn't run her speaking group.
Sure.
And I know we corrected, I correct them at the beginning all the time because it's parroting. The first week or two, it's literally parroting, that's all you do. After that, I see how a student reacts to the corrections, how confident they are or not, and then we'll do it really individualized for each student.
Thanks.
Okay.
How about writing skills? Because
That's a different topic. We focus on speaking here.
But writing improves speaking sometimes.
Yes, it can also be absolutely counterproductive to developing speaking.
How?
We have a student who writes beautifully, cannot say 2 words.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So, and let's focus on the speaker. We still have stuff to. We will give you time. I can't answer the question. Yes.
Well, I'm totally with you. We're at the same page. Regarding the idea of loosen up, you know, to make the feel free to speak out. But at the same time, it's just my question. I'm not arguing, just my question. I'm very much interested in this. Do you think letting students speak Russian with wrong pronunciation and it just makes a muscle memory to get this wrong? Ideas about sounding Russian.
Yeah, that's a very good observation. So we correct their pronunciation a lot during class, official structured class time. They read out loud to us, grammar classes, even speaking classes, we ask them to repeat what they heard. So that is the time to really remind them this is how you make this sound, that sound, and so on and so forth. But there should be time for fun. And also when we correct them, sometimes it goes like this, oh, she's picking on me. If I say, I cannot understand you, they know I'm playing. But when somebody else does not understand them, then dude, something is wrong, your pronunciation is off. Okay, we have to hurry up and we have a really fun project to show you. So please hold the questions to the end. So in week 8, we do a robot voiceover. That was our way to jumpstart their learning after the Exodus, because we assumed they wouldn't do much. So what we did, we took the video of the Boston robots, made it mute, and then when the students came, first hour, Monday or Tuesday, whatever it was after Exodus, we put them into the big conference room and said, okay, you have 15 minutes working with a partner, come up with a voiceover. And we wanted to see what they remember and what they can produce without preparation and see how it goes. And it turned out to be very interesting because we had adventurous students who chose to have fun with the language. Mm-hmm. And we had students who took it very academically. They pulled out the textbooks and they went chapter by chapter by chapter to review the vocab and the grammar. So we'll show you what our adventurous group did.
Я дома. Папа, открой эти двери, пожалуйста.
Конечно. Я тоже очень рад, что я дома.
Сегодня я был в школе. Хороший день.
Да. Здравствуйте, моя женя. Привет, дочь. Что вы говорите?
Большое спасибо, папа.
So if you don't speak Russian, you have the translation of the handout.
Вы открываете дверь, я не хочу это.
Нет, я хочу открывать, это секретная дверь.
Не открывайте эту дверь.
Я хочу секрет.
Я иду сказать полиции.
Рассказы полиции.
А вот
отлично. Я один. Что в этой комнате? И я открываю дверь. Сейчас я вижу секрет. Это мой первый день на работе.
Это коробка бомба, Саша.
Борис, что вы делаете?
Стоп, Саша. Это коробка бомба.
Боже мой, Борис, стоп. У меня есть эта коробка.
Когда у вас есть эта коробка, я сказал тик-тик-тик.
Боже мой, Борис, стоп.
А, сейчас я иду на улицу.
Нет, Боря, это не помню.
Okay. So, you heard them laughing in the background. And if you have your handout, you would see red there. They made mistakes. Some of the pronunciation was eh, but we could understand it in context. Some of the verbs they did not conjugate properly, but yet again, we could understand it in, you know, in the context. So the idea was, you know, practice, not perfection. They came from the vacation, they used the language, they had fun with it, they were motivated to learn, and they were not afraid to speak and make mistakes because, you know, I live here 20 years, I still make mistakes in my English. What is happening here? All right. So very quickly, what else do we do with Tour?
We're going to go through what else do we do. We try to make our classes a little bit more interactive. And through the since the day one, we started with a rapping game by presenting them an alphabet. And throughout the course, we're giving them like little counting poems, and it's interesting because they learn at the early stages of their language acquisition, they learn those poems, and then now in the third semester, they using those words that they didn't know any idea how to translate them at the beginning of their learning road. We also use songs in our classrooms, and it doesn't matter if you sing relatively well or not. You know, as my colleague said, we're all in the same boat, and if students can embarrass themselves in front of everyone, we can embarrass ourselves too in front of them. That's why we do it all together, and you know, it helps them. Some of the students are very musically, they have a very good ear, yeah. Some of them playing different musical instruments. They love singing songs in a target language, and that helps them to learn the language. And as Marcia says, there is no dignity in language learning. That's why you need to live it somewhere else. And
So we do not do songs randomly. We make sure that they fit the context of what we are doing, or the grammar, or vocab, or all of it in the perfect world. We also do something where we actually ask them to memorize it, even though in our speaking classes they do not memorize their essays. Their essay is a brainstorming session. We ask them to come and just, I take away their essay, they have nothing to rely on except themselves and maybe a little squishable to calm the nerves, and then I expect them to just talk to me. And that's our team, that is one thing that I require all the teachers on my team to do. No reading of your essay. Please do not memorize your essay, it's not gonna help you unless it is a special case. So one thing that they actually memorize from get-go is how to introduce yourself in the target language. And this is one thing we ask them to do it in a very complicated way. So they have to say the name, the rank, where they study, and then where do they live. And it all uses different cases. That's for Russians, the grammar. So by the time we come to learn a new grammar item, they already been using it for a long time and they really accept it easier. It's not that difficult for them to get over the fact that instead of preposition, we use endings and things change meaning
at the whim of nobody knows who, teacher, student, or context. So our outcomes, our students speak quite freely. They feel they have a living language by the end of the first semester. They make mistakes. They forget the words. They do circumlocution. They describe it instead of naming it, but they can communicate. It's a lot more enjoyable learning process than to just memorize and regurgitate everything that you memorize.
The projects I received are better for our students, and unfortunately this year our class didn't have an opportunity to go abroad, and Russian students usually go to Latvia, and for some of the students it helps a lot, and the environment that we create for our students in the class can substitute the lack of the off-class programs, of course to a degree, but at the same time I know that they're bringing the awkwardness back, but we try to do our best to make sure that our students emerged into the language, and at the end it helps them, you know. And that's all that we wanted to present to you today. If you have any questions for future.
Now is a great time to have a questions and discussion. Thank you.
This is a question with the robot for a voice over. How does that work? For example, the video clips, did you provide them or did the students find that?
No, I stumbled upon it. I thought it was hilarious.
Was it from YouTube?
And then I just ran it through the program that lifted the audio of it. And then we did it very low tech. The students stood by the board and just spoke, and I recorded them.
So you just
tried
like
to
sound.
Have their face in the picture.
You just played the movie without the sound, and then to make up the script.
Yeah.
And it wasn't any translation, they just made up
No, they just, from get-go, they had to do it in Russian. We also tell them think in the target language, it's the hardest to nail.
Say whatever they wanted to,
Any other questions?
I have two questions, a bit short. Have you treated the, some global students or, you know, some students are global, some are very analytical. So have you guys treated them differently or, I mean, as far as, you know, promoting their speaking proficiency or, you know, as you also give an example of breaking down is hell for analytical students. They become more analytical. You have to bring them up to the surface, you know, making them a little bit of global. So have you guys did anything differently? My second question was, what would be your suggestion for us? Like, we should not do besides breaking down. Any other lesson learned from?
You know, this particular class that we're ready to graduate is all visual kinesthetic, and so are we.
Sure.
So we told them, since you guys are all visual, say goodbye to the visuals.
Okay.
Because you need to relearn how to act without relying on the anything. So we just made really focused effort to wean them off the dependency of the paper and have them learn to use the ears. The same about students who are global and detailed. We have students who are global. We have students who are detailed.
Right.
And we work with them to have one, then kind
to
of even it out. We acknowledge it. I have meetings with students, goal setting meetings and progress report meetings. And we go over those things and we give them strategies. In class, we cannot really, you know, provide individual everything for everybody. But we work with them individually to help them develop the skills they need to develop in order to successfully pass the course. And the advice we're going to give you is don't be afraid to be silly with your students. This is very intense environment. And while you want to maintain very high standards, like we have very high expectations, we expect nothing but the best from our students, but we always find time to have fun with them. Because otherwise it's stressful for everybody. Thank you.
Thank you.